All right. What you need to know about the proof of claim forms you'll be sent by the disability carrier. Now, the requirements for the proof of loss are not the same requirements as providing notice. And so let me give you another example of a proof of loss provision in a disability policy. The petition and return of the claim form, or if needed, the letter described in the notice of the claim section above will serve as a proper filing of proof of loss. That's really confusing, isn't it? It goes on to say, this filing must be received in our office no later than 90 days after the end of the period for which benefits are claimed. Benefits won't be reduced due to the delay, and filing a proof of loss if it was filed as reasonably as possible. In no event will we accept a filing of proof of loss of more than a year after it's due. And that provision won't apply if you weren't competent to make the claim. So you can see in these proof of loss forms, provisions rather, that there are time frames in which they expect that you're going to be submitting this documentation. And if you don't submit it timely, they may say, too bad, so sad. These provisions, as you can understand, based on what I just said, are rather confusing. And so that's another reason why you want to get your disability policy out and read the provisions before you stop working and apply for benefits. Because we want to really be on top of this game. We want to control when we're filing for disability, the quality of the disability application, and we obviously want to do it properly. So let's talk about what is properly. There are generally in a disability policy a clause called proof of your claim, and it might say something about what it is you have to submit as proof of claim. You need to really, really read this provision closely. You need to make sure you understand it thoroughly before you file your claim, because four of the most common reasons for denials of claims, I think, are found in the proof of claim section. And I'm going to discuss that later under claims denial. So what does the typical proof of claim provision say? It says something like this. What information is needed as proof of your claim? That you're under the regular care of a doctor. The appropriate documentation of your monthly earnings. The date your disability began. The cause of your disability. The extent of your disability, including restrictions and limitations that prevent you from performing your regular occupation. The name and address of any hospital or institution where you receive treatment, including all attending forms. All attending doctors. Now, the policy will probably go on to say that we can request that you send proof of continuing disability indicating that you're under the regular care of a doctor. This proof is provided at your expense, and it has to be sent in within 30 days of the request by us. And again, you may be required to provide me, being the carrier, with notice of any change in your medical providers, and we want authorization to get additional medical information. So we want proof of continuing disability, or we're going to deny your claim or stop sending your payments if the appropriate information is not submitted. Well, that's a whole lot of language, isn't it? So let's break this down. What does regular care of a doctor mean? Well, there are two crucial parts of that definition, regular care and doctor. So once again, we've got to go get that policy out. Regular care could be defined as something like you personally visit a doctor as frequently as medically required, according to generally accepted medical standards, to effectively manage and treat your disabling condition. Whew. Now, in the day of telemedicine, I think that will pass, certainly during the era of COVID here. But the other key provision is as frequently as medically required, according to generally accepted medical standards. Well, might come a time in your case where the doctor says, I don't need to see you as frequently. I only need to see you every 6 months or once a year. I would be saying to you, you need to see the doctor at least every 3 months, because you want to be able to establish that your treatment is and your condition is being effectively managed, because that's another key provision in that definition. But there's more to that definition. A regular care is defined as receiving the most appropriate treatment and care which conforms to generally accepted medical standards for your disabling condition by a doctor whose specialty or experience is most appropriate for your disabling condition according to generally accepted medical standards. I have clients who want to try alternative medication, and I get it. But I think that you have to have exhausted appropriate medical treatment and care before you try alternative medicine. If you go right to alternative medicine, I promise you, the carrier is going to deny your claim. The other issue with this definition is a doctor whose specialty or experience is most appropriate for your disabling condition. So let's say you've got fibromyalgia. Should you be treating with a family doctor or a rheumatologist? Well, pretty clear, you should be treating with a rheumatologist. So the carrier just might get bent out of shape because you're not being treated by the right specialist. So what does the word doctor mean? A person performing tasks that within the limits of their medical license, a person who's licensed to practice medicine, prescribe and administer drugs, or perform surgery. A person with a doctorate degree in psychology whose primary practice is treating patients. A person who is a legally qualified medical practitioner according to the laws and regulations of the governing jurisdiction. And by the way, we will recognize you or your spouse, children, parents, or siblings as a doctor for any claim. So you've got to prove to the disability carrier that you're seeing a physician as often as required for the diagnosis. And that can, again, be a problem, particularly in psychological claims. Well, claims involving depression or anxiety is a situation where, depending on the severity of the depression or anxiety, might be as little as twice a month. So you might be seeing a qualified therapist, psychologist, or psychiatrist, but you may not be seeing them as frequently as the carrier wants. And it's not uncommon for claims to be denied on the basis that the level of care you receive is not appropriate based on the frequency of the care, the lack of testing, the lack of participation, the lack of recommendation of counseling, including group therapy, the lack of counseling in combination with medications, or referrals to other specialists. The problem with these definitions is that they are so broad that carriers use them as a license to create requirements that really don't exist in the terms of the policy. They kind of make up their interpretation of what regular care is as they go along, depending on what they want to do with your claim. Now, disability insurance carriers are going to routinely hire board-certified in-house liar-for-hire physicians or peer-review physicians to review your claim. It's guaranteed. And that's particularly true in psychiatric or psychological claim, where there's a lack of documentation in your medical chart regarding the basis of the diagnosis. Observations about your ability to function, which seem to be inconsistent with the restrictions and limitations that you're suffering, and a lack of treatment plan. If you're not getting regular care, you can destroy your claim, even though you might have a problem paying for the care. You might have lost your group insurance. You might not be able to afford the medication. There are many facilities that offer low or no cost medical care that you should take advantage of if you lose your health insurance. It's important that you get this medical care, not only because it improves your medical condition, but it assists you in both your long-term disability claim and a Social Security disability claim. Now, remember, the care has to be appropriate. I find often that doctor's records just don't document the extent, nature, and level of the care that's being required. And you've got a problem through no fault of your own. And it might be necessary to have your physician write a detailed letter for which they're going to charge you for that sets forth the testing they perform, the care they're providing, and confirm that the care that you're getting is appropriate based on your symptomatology. If your doctor refuses, it might be time to change a physician and find one that supports your claim and will document your file appropriately. Now, another provision in these policies is regular and ongoing medical care. They're going to continually ask you and your doctor to provide office treatment notes that document not only you're seeing the physician on a regular basis, but that the care is appropriate. So let's talk about the definition of regular and appropriate care. We may request that you send proof of continuing disability indicating that you're under the care of a doctor. This proof, provided at your own expense, has to be received within 45 days. And if you don't provide it to us, then we are potentially going to deny your claim. Now, again, this doesn't tell you what regular is, doesn't necessarily tell you what appropriate is, and you've got to figure it out because you're contractually obligated to provide proof of regular and ongoing treatment. So I would be sitting down with your doctor and saying to them, what is regular, what's appropriate, and could you please document the frequency and the nature of the treatment you're recommending in my medical records. Now, the other issue is going to be the date of disability, the cause of disability, and restrictions and limitations. And we've talked about this before. And while they like the APS forms, they really want to see the office treatment notes to document the ongoing proof of your treatment and your disability. Now, carriers are going to request those records because they have a fiduciary duty to investigate your claim under the ERISA statute. Now, there's no contractual obligation for them to request the medical information on your behalf, though sometimes they do. But it really is, at the end of the day, your responsibility to provide the carrier with proof that it needs to evaluate your initial claim and your ongoing claim. That includes, what is the date of your disability? What's the cause of your disability? Do you have a herniated disc that causes tickling and numbness that runs down your leg that makes it difficult for you to sit more than 20 minutes? So they want to know the restrictions and limitations. You can see again that it's really crucial that you're reading your disability insurance policy so that you understand what goes into the notice of claim. I'm putting you on claim, a notice that I'm filing a claim, and what goes in that proof of claim form in terms of the diagnosis, the treatment, and any other documentation that the carrier wants to see to evaluate your claim. All right, you ready to take another break? When we come back, I'm going to discuss the role of doctors in your application for benefits.
Are you a professional with questions about your individual disability policy? You need the Disability Insurance Claim Survival Guide for Professionals. This book gives you a comprehensive understanding of your disability policy with tips and to-dos regarding your disability application that will assist you in submitting a winning disability application. This is one you won't want to miss. For the next 24 hours, we are giving away free copies of the Disability Insurance Claim Survival Guide for Professionals. Order yours today at disabilityclaimsforprofessionals.com.